Now, one thing is certain. No one expected the invasion of Crimea. The Maidan revolution and the change of power in the capital got all the attention. When the new government finally turned their attention to Crimea, all the Ukrainian military units were already blocked by unknown troops without any identification marks. This Friday, Operation Crimea, exclusively on Ukraine Today.
This month marks the one-year anniversary of the Russian seizure of Crimea. No community has suffered as much as human rights have deteriorated in the peninsula as the Crimean Tatars. We've been joined today in the Ukraine Today newsroom by Ibraim Umerov, who's the representative for the Kyiv Crimean Tatar community. Ibrahim, thanks very much for joining us. Could we begin by just giving us an update? What is the current human rights situation in Crimea, and how many Crimean Tatars have left the peninsula over the past year?
Yes, we can say that last weeks we can see the bigger pressure on Crimean Tatars, and we can say that a new wave of repressions and oppressions is started now. And till this time, we can say that totally nearly 20,000 of citizens of Ukraine from Crimea left the peninsula, and maybe half of them are Crimean Tatars. So we can say about 10,000 of Crimean Tatars who now live abroad from Crimea.
Where have the majority moved to? Have they stayed within Ukraine? Mm.
Yes, the majority is stay in Ukraine, and big communities now in Lviv and in Vinnytsia and in Kherson region. And some of them, of course, went to Poland and to the Turkey. That's why, but most full they stay in Ukraine. Crimea will come back to Ukraine, and they can, will be able to come back to their homeland.
If we can go back to the events of last year when this, when the seizure of Crimea began, so the seizure of the parliamentary building in Simferopol, the occupation or the blockage of the military bases, of the airport, the infrastructure. You were in Crimea at the time, as I understand. At what point did you realize that this was really going to go all the way, that the Russians would annex the territory? At what point did you realize this wasn't just going to be some sort of a political game, but it, this was the real thing?
Till the end, till the sign of Putin, we was thinking that they will not do this, because it's big mistake for themselves, and but they do, they have done this, and until this day we hope that it will not continue so long.
So even after the referendum, you know, at the time of the referendum, you thought that they would vote and then they would have some compromise, or
yes, of course, we but you know, maybe that day of referendum, and when they do this like they wanted before, and when they claim their results that was were known before, and maybe that day we understand, yes, they will go so far.
Now, with the community, the Crimean Tatar community now being dispersed partly throughout Ukraine, but the majority remains in Crimea. In terms of numbers, we're talking around about 250,000, 300,000,
yes,
people.
So more than 300,000.
So the vast majority are still in Crimea. Presumably they intend to stay in Crimea.
Yes, of course.
What does the future hold for them under Russian occupation?
You know, it's hard to see any future for Crimea at all under the Russian occupation, because they don't need their some normal life for people, because the only thing they need in Crimea is a place to for the Navy forces, and they don't need that 3.5 million of Crimeans who live now there. Maybe 1 million is enough for them, and it's better for them that Crimean Tatars and other Russians, Ukrainians will go away from Russia. And as we can say, what we see now, they really make a very hard life. Before they was promising that teachers in schools and universities doctors in hospitals, everyone will get a bigger salary, and also will take bigger pensions. But after the beginning of this year, everything of the promises like stopped, and before they really showed like we pay you more cash, but now it's even became worse. And people see this, not only Crimean Tatars now see that Russian politics is based on lie, like all the propaganda and all they do, also their promises is lie.
But the Russian position is such now that it's very difficult to imagine how Putin or the Kremlin could go back now, mm-hmm. after the amount of political capital they've invested in Crimea. So presumably the Crimean Tatar community is expecting to live for a prolonged period under Russian occupation.
Yes, of course, it's our homeland, and we know we have no any other place to go. And now we should understand that Crimean Tatars is a native nation of Crimea. And as a native nation, native people, they have right to decide, to make decisions for Crimea. And if we will not take this to our opinions, it will be so hard to make something in Crimea. So as Russians say, it is the voice of Crimeans. There is no definition of Crimeans in any policy, and but if we will say about the native people, then we should care about Crimean Tatars and some little nations like Krimchak and Karaims there.
A lot of the international attention at the moment surrounding Ukraine has moved away from Crimea to an extent and is focusing on the conflict in East Ukraine. So we have the Minsk talks, the sanctions, very much concentrated on the issue of stopping the fighting, stopping the bloodshed. And to the extent where Crimea has moved a little bit off the radar, geopolitically speaking, sometimes we don't even hear it mentioned when declarations are made in Brussels and Washington and when talks are being held. Are you afraid, is the Crimean community concerned, the Crimean Tatar community, excuse me, are you concerned that people will forget about the Crimean issue?
We're not afraid that they will forget this at all, because we are there and we will not give anyone to forget this. And but we're really disturbed by that fact that Crimea is not in the topic of a lot of meetings. And really, Crimean Tatars in Crimea, they see this, and some of them, some Crimean Tatars and Russians and Ukrainians in Crimea who want to come Ukraine back, they really disturbed by that Crimea is not the topic of discussion.
So they're aware of this, they've noticed
yes,
this?
Yes, yeah? They notice this, and of course they see this more worst because of Russian propaganda again. They any Crimean citizen of Ukraine in Crimea can watch Ukrainian TV channels or any others. They shut down them before that referendum in the first day of March. They shut down Chernomorska TV channel and One Plus One, any fifth channel, any Ukrainian channels, and they turn on Russian channels. And till this day, they broadcasting their channels, and only their information is available to Crimeans.
We very often see at demonstrations and rallies and political protests Ukrainian flags, and alongside them the Crimean Tatar flag.
Yes.
Also blue and yellow.
Yes.
So can you just explain a little bit, how does that make you feel as a Crimean Tatar to come to Kyiv and around the world as well, and to see this solidarity that now exists between the Ukrainian nation and the Crimean Tatar people?
Yes, you know, after revolution of last year, Ukrainian nation is transformed to a new step, and it's a new level when Crimean Tatars are also Ukrainians. Russians are also Ukrainians, and any other minorities are also Ukrainians, because of it's our state, and we care about it together. That's why now we see this, and even after this occupation in parliament, there was took some decisions about Crimean Tatars, like we will protect them and we will recognize Mejlis and Kurultai, the Crimean Tatar parliament. And when we saw these steps from Kyiv, we understood that really now it is the chance to Ukraine and for Crimean Tatars especially to build a new homeland.
Ibraim, thank you very much for joining us. It was a pleasure to have you into the newsroom today. We wish you all the best of luck. And now a look back to how it began 1 year ago, a special Ukraine Today documentary, Operation Crimea.
Warriors, Marines, defenders of our native Crimean land. You should understand that the illegitimate government in Kyiv has seized authority by a military coup. It gives you criminal commands against your own people.
From morning till night, they hear demands to lay down arms. For hundreds of times, I've seen our soldiers in exercises, a few times on peacekeeping missions abroad, but never at war on their own territory. Even now, when this Marine battalion is surrounded by enemies, it's hard to believe that all this is a reality.
Galinov, why are you wearing your peacoats?
But this is a military reality. Ukrainian soldiers are being forced to surrender under the threat of an assault.
Friends and acquaintances from Russia ask us, what happened over there? Everything is okay. It's all right. Just the ordinary, everyday field days. That is all. Are they worried about you? Of course, friends, acquaintances, and relatives are worried, but actually, nothing has happened. Everything is okay.
This is Vlad, a contract Marine and Grenadier platoon commander. They're in the process of fortifying the headquarters.
Why the hell are you here so much? What do you mean? I have nothing to do with it. A new shift has come on. Good. Right now, as four of you are here together, take this broken-down thing with the barbed wire to that gate. Prop up the gate with it, and bring the hedgehogs here. Questions? No. Okay, go on.
The red alarm sign in the headquarters is always kept on. This means the soldiers are always on combat alert. Ammo boxes are open. Everyone carries weapons and additional allotments are rounds. Around the clock, the perimeter is guarded by sentries and snipers.
Is someone hiding there? We have an unexpected guest. Over. Press harder. Could you ask someone to bring a cape? It's starting to rain.
Now one thing is certain. No one expected the invasion of Crimea. The Maidan revolution and the change of power in the capital got all the attention. When the new government finally turned their attention to Crimea, all the Ukrainian military units were already blocked by unknown troops without any identification marks. One of the first seized military units was the Tactical Aviation Brigade in Belbek, near Sebastopol. Our fighter jets were based there. Now, as all the runways were blocked, the aircraft were grounded, while the pilots were guarding the headquarters, the only building still under their control.
I could start from the 27th. On February 27th at 9:30 p.m., I got information from the duty ship from the Belbek airdrome as a commander. Unidentified Ural and Kamaz model trucks have arrived to the Belbek airdrome in the long-term parking. Within 15 minutes, I arrived there and witnessed soldiers without identifying signs. They had Russian uniforms on.
Even a month earlier, who could have predicted that Crimea would be captured so easily, without a declaration of war and a single shot fired? Just like that, quickly and quietly. All the military units are blocked by an unknown army. The invaders have no insignia on their uniforms, but plenty of weapons.
Why didn't you fire upon them when they first broke in? They were on the territory of a sensitive site. There were 350 well-armed people with machine guns, automatic rifles, and sniper rifles, and against them were three people with Makarov guns. What do you think? Is a confrontation reasonable?
Yuli Mamchur, the brigade commander, became a hero even without a fight. He and his men set out and blocked the runways. Armed with just a flag and a patriotic song, they marched towards the gun-wielding invaders. And were met with shots fired into the air.
1, 2, 3, forward! This is our land! 1, 2, 3, forward! Forward! Where are the owners here? Go ahead, shoot, you bitch! Do not provoke. Hold it right there. Hold. Halt. It's a Soviet flag. Are you going to shoot? Our commander will come soon. It's our colors from 1941. Commander, calm them down. All right, Olegovich. That's enough. Calm down. Drop back immediately.
The people who seized the airfield had the bearings of professional military. They sported modern weapons and used advanced equipment. A Russian manufacturer, the vehicle is in service of Russia's armed forces.
I'm also a local. I'm happy to see you here, but why are you armed? Why am I armed? Because you provoked us. Are you a Russian soldier? No. Calm down. But what are you doing here? I'm not going to comment on anything. I asked them what country they served and who gave them the orders. They refused to answer those questions and comment on it.
Now, such vehicles can often be seen in Crimea. We shot this video on the Simferopol-Sebastopol highway, a convoy of Tigers with numbers assigned to the 21st administrative region of the Russian Federation. The wives of our soldiers had it all verified.
The cars have Russian vehicle identification numbers of the 21st region. The 21st region of Russia is Chebuksary.
Real spring has come to Crimea, and this may look like a regular picnic in front of a military unit. The wives of Ukrainian pilots provide both support and a kind of safeguard against violence. They are certain that on the opposite side, there are military servicemen who, just like their husbands, would never shoot civilians.
We are permanently here. We only leave for an hour or so. We will stay here as much as is needed. I left for an hour. We leave to feed our kids and then come back. We'll still sit here till morning, that's for sure.
Are they still on the field? Still there. So far, we can't kick them out, but we will. I know that. This is our land and our unit, and we will stand to the end. In general, how do they behave? They carry out their orders. They are military men just like us. Whenever they get orders, they carry them out. It's the same with us. We do what we are ordered. We are all ordinary servicemen. So,
the lawn between the military dormitory and the unit's circulation control office is the only place free of Russian soldiers. All the approaches to the airfield are blocked. The only way they can talk to their families is through the fence, because the unit is on high alert and no one is allowed to leave its territory.
Daddy, do you need a spoon?
No, it's okay.
Is this Daddy's coffee? Yes, I'm making coffee for Daddy.
How long has Daddy been locked in?
For 3 days. Be careful, it's hot.
Let's take it, honey. I'll be right back. I'll just take it somewhere.
Then you will return to me.
I won't say goodbye. I will come back. I'll take it.
Even we were born in the Soviet Union, we were always brothers. There are so many Ukrainians living in Russia, so many Russians living in Ukraine. Actually, we're brothers, but each army has their orders. They get theirs, we get ours. Although our soldiers don't want war and bloodshed, for what? We need a peaceful solution.
This woman also serves in the army.
For 21 years.
You've served for 21 years?
Yes, since I was 19 until now, my father is an honored pilot, a decorated pilot sniper. I followed in his steps. Where should I put it? Is it visible? Do you have children? Yes.
The fact that it was Russians who captured Crimea was proved not just by columns of military hardware with Russian vehicle registration plates. Soldiers who blocked Ukrainian military units don't even bother to conceal uniform stripes with their ranks and Russian surnames on them. Some servicemen of the Feodosia Marine Battalion happened to know the invaders personally.
We know a lot of those people. We've known them for a long time. We practiced maneuvers together. We've often been in the field together. We've met and talked at different events.
На различных мероприятиях мы встречались, общались.
So we know a lot of them. Vlad, do you think they might attack? I doubt it. Those guys are more tired than we are. Because we have an advantage. Our soldiers go to sleep inside a sleeping bag after their patrol. Over there, they sleep in cold armored infantry vehicles. Sooner or later, a human body wears out. No one will order an attack. They're just waiting for some sort of provocation. That's it. It's all about whose nerves give out first. It's not going to be ours. We are not supposed to sleep. Do you want to? You cannot sleep here. Most will survive.
The so-called People's Militia consists of aggressive pro-Russian elements. 1 month earlier, some of them were hired by the authorities to attend anti-Maidan rallies at the Mariinsky Park in Kyiv, St. George ribbon being their traditional trademark. These people explain that Russian troops are here to protect Crimea's Russian speakers from radicals who seized power in Kyiv.
Почему, например, тогда меня как журналиста не пускают к части? Вот я пытался
пройти. Они вообще, там вообще не положено никому находиться.
Ну,
кроме военных.
А вот военные вот эти ребята, это
не военные, это такие же военные.
Так а военные такие украинские, российские какие?
Народное ополчение Крыма. Уже сказали все. Нет, вы еще спрашиваете.
А откуда у них оружие?
Да? А как же, защищать нас?
Бойцы, no комментарий, no.
А как вас зовут? Вы старше, так понимаю, чтобы мы титр поставили?
Нет, это по-английски, но...
А вас как зовут?
Это сам, это да, ёхтер была.
Это Черчилль.
Ой-ой-ой. Этих солдат не надо бояться.
Эти нас защищают.
В Киеве люди боятся.
Надо
ходить,
бояться тех киевских майданутых.
У меня знакомые
бандитов.
В Киеве, и они
говорят,
они боятся
белые, вот кого
выпускать
надо.
Детей. А у нас дети гуляют.
Там идет своих, беспредел,
и
садиках, грабеж.
И в школах. А там нет.
Вот вам и свободная нынька Украина. Вот вам результат. Теперь будем хлебать все щи пустые.
Да.
Это удочку?
Ну, мало плага, символики нет.
The same kind of mantra about Kyiv's atrocities can be heard in Crimea at each and every rally. An aggression is aimed not just at journalists, but at ordinary locals who happen to have a dissenting opinion.
Нас ни от кого не надо защищать. Я не боюсь. Вы понимаете, что страх – это психология раба. Понимаете?
Женщина, что вы хотите?
Что вы слушаете Путина? Путина, не надо, тихо, я не
уважаю.
Не надо меня. Ведь у нас Крым был и есть украинский, и он будет к Украине. Не надо мне, чтобы жизнь становилась кровью. А вы хотите кровью все, понимаете? И делаете провокацию для того, чтобы мы боялись. И тихо, я не боюсь. Я вам говорю.
Вы провокаторы, бабушка.
Да, давай, провокаторы. Вот. Бабуль, не надо.
Это
давай,
провокаторы. Ребят,
не
ну,
надо.
Тихо.
The Crimean self-defense affirms that they tried to avoid any provocations. However, they are the ones who provoke Ukrainian soldiers.
I think they were recruited in the middle of recent events. It's the same gang, members of marginal groups. It's the same contingent comprised of tetushki.
This group of young people is trying to get into the Marine Battalion's territory and cut off power. The Manual of Guard Duties states that if an outsider penetrates the territory, sentries may shoot to kill. Under the given circumstances, that could provoke a real war. That's why our soldiers didn't shoot. They simply tried to chase off the intruders.
We blocked the way to the power switches and turned them off. Why did you shut them off? Minik told us to. We don't know anything. Leave us alone. Minik came with our superiors. They turned off the power, told us to block the exits, so we did, and we left six people on guard. Minik told us to turn the switch? I think he himself did it. Minik turned it off, right? Yes.
Minik выключал, да?
Yuri Minik is the leader of the Feodosian Cossack Regiment. He was one of those who provoked numerous clashes with Crimean Tatars in Feodosia. Apart from other things, he was behind the illegal attempts to install Orthodox crosses at the entrance to the city. That was highly praised in the Crimean internet publication Novoros Info. 1 year earlier, long before the Maidan, the Ukrainian Security Service gave us information on this publication, according to which, in 2012, near Moscow, a conference was held for Crimea's pro-Russian media. After the conference, the Russian Fund for Legal Aid and Protection of Compatriots' Rights Abroad gave a grant of a quarter of a million Ukrainian hryvnias to a little website called Novoros Info.
Є різні групи, є автономні групи, наприклад, там група Соболь, там є оця група Мініха.
There are different autonomous groups, like the Sobol group, Minik's group, there are Crimean Cossacks. In general, there are groups like that. There is a military unit from the lower Zaporizhian forces. They are all xenophobes, Russian nationalists. They are anti-Tatars and anti-Ukrainian.
If you watch carefully the part of the footage where a woman is attacked in front of the Feodosia battalion, you can spot the same Cossack, Yuri Minich, and it won't be hard to understand who could benefit by provoking Ukrainian servicemen.
They say they are providing protection. From whom? Is that how they provide protection? Unless we do something? We don't want to. Even people in Sebastopol say, who invited you here? But really, they all want to join Russia. Whoever wants to join Russia, go ahead. Go to your Russia. Go to Moscow. Take Russian citizenship. Live in Russia and do whatever you want. Crimea is a part of Ukraine. How about we invade Krasnodar through Kerch and protect the Ukrainians who live there? I want to go to Estonia. Where are you from? I'm from Feodosia in Crimea. From Feodosia? Yes, I was born in this house. I've lived here for over 20 years. I wish it was more peaceful here. Do you have a lot of colleagues who consider themselves ethnic Russians? There may be a lot of Russians, but switching sides is a whole different thing. Everyone has his own point of view, but now I've sworn an oath of a Marine. I've sworn fidelity to the Ukrainian people. I stand for my commander. I protect my family. Everyone tries to avoid bloodshed at any cost. That's the situation. Who are the people? It's me and my family. The whole of Ukraine is a big family. It's not just empty words from a Marine.
И Украина – это, в общем, в этом плане, как бы, все это в совокупности. Для морского пехотинца это не просто слова.
Для нас нет врагов здесь. Есть просто…
We have no enemies here. Only the people who want to cause conflict between us and the Russian Federation. We ignore these things.
Какого бы то конфликта. Вот. Мы не обращаем на эти вещи внимания.
Operation Crimea wouldn't have been such an easy success for Russians had it not been for a massive brainwashing campaign they had run on the peninsula for years. I myself grew up in Crimea, and I can assure you that in recent years, Russia's media propaganda substantially boosted pro-Russian sentiments. Besides, Crimeans never liked the fact that they couldn't choose their officials directly, but had them sent from Kyiv. On one of the first days of the occupation, a deputy of the Crimean parliament arrived to a Ukrainian military unit. The sincerity of his argument leaves no doubt about his position.
As of today, the autonomous republic de jure exists. De facto, we already have foresters from Makiivka and Donetsk. We do not belong to ourselves. I am a parliamentary deputy. I sat through the most prestigious committee. I sat on the most prestigious committee. I want everybody to hear this. Just so you know, guess what I voted for? Once a year, to approve a budget, and once more to nominate some awards. Is this autonomy?
The new Crimean government assures that Russia will give the peninsula more powers, and that is worth fighting for. But this is politics. To understand why ordinary Crimeans wanted secession, one should know local sentiments. Most Russian-speaking Crimeans never supported either the Euromaidan or the Orange Revolution. For them, all that was about Ukrainianization. For the previous 2 months, Russia's media and Crimean politicians spread endless stories about armed nationalists allegedly coming to Crimea to take down monuments and make everyone speak Ukrainian. It may sound funny to people in Kyiv, but for Crimeans, it was damn serious. So now, everyone who comes from mainland Ukraine is called a Banderite. Ironically, even the Ukrainian military have also become Banderites, even though most of them are Russian-speaking Crimean residents who have nothing to do with Kyiv's revolutionary developments.
We don't support them. It was against the law. It was so stupid, to be honest. Unlawful seizure of power. Right, I think we should have waited for the elections. The president who was chosen by the people should have finished his term. It's not just my opinion. Most of us think like that. All. Yes. The opposition is wrong. This is nonsense. I think this isn't power, but squatting. It's simply... On the other hand, we have to carry out our orders from the Minister of Defense.
Who?
We don't carry out the Minister's orders. Just those of our commander and no one else. We have our battalion commander and we are subordinate to him. Where he gets his orders is his business. We listen to him.
The Crimean police also take a dim view of the change of power in Kyiv. The Berkut riot police, who served in Maidan during the revolution, returned to a hero's welcome in Crimea. The decision to disband the special unit was taken not as a punishment for excessive violence, but as revenge. Kyiv could no longer rely on the Crimean police. Meanwhile, Russia was biding her time until anti-Ukrainian moves in Crimea concurred with the weakening of the central government. Russia's support was enlisted by deputy of the Crimean parliament, Sergei Aksyonov. And even though his Russian Unity Party had garnered just 4% of the votes in the last elections, it was he who headed the self-proclaimed Crimean government.
I understand the lives and peace of the Crimean residents is my responsibility. So I decided to ask Vladimir Putin for help to obtain his assistance in restoring constitutional order on the territory of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea.
In fact, those who call themselves Crimea's new government have long been enjoying Russia's support, primarily money-wise. This is the office of Russian cooperation in Simferopol, a big mansion downtown. The task of this organization is to support Russians abroad. Its branches are found in every country where Russian interests are involved. It allows Russia to legally put money to NGOs, which are supposed to rock the boat from the inside. According to Ihor Semivolos, financing of Russian separatists in Crimea was channeled through this Russian cooperation structure.
They operated through the Russian cooperation. Kolesnichenko was the only one who managed the money. Most of the money went through him. Now he is in Crimea and is most likely operating this entire operation.
No one is ready to cite exact figures, but they don't even try to deny connection with the self-proclaimed Crimean government. For example, the father of the new vice president of Crimea, Rustam Timurgaliyev, is a businessman, Ilmir Timurgaliyev, a member of the Crimean Coordination Council Board of the Russian Compatriots Organization, who frequents this office. Another link is through Russia's Cossack organizations. Currently, it is their members who guard all the government institutions and highway checkpoints in Crimea. The Kuban Cossacks came right after the change of power, ostensibly to protect the Russian speakers, and they do mean business.
As a representative of these people, how can I stand aside while the Russian-speaking people here are in such serious danger? It's the call of my heart. In line with the Cossacks? Yes, the people invited us. The Black Sea Cossacks as well. They all collaborate with the Krasnodar region and their Cossacks. They're one in essence. Most of the Cossacks are now recruited from the Krasnodar region and sent to Crimea through Kerch.
This man in camouflage trousers is not a Cossack, but he came from the Caucasus also to protect Russian speakers. Now he stands at a checkpoint where all the cars heading for Sebastopol are stopped for inspection.
I don't give a damn what country it will be. Ukraine, America, as long as Russians are safe, I will not be here. If Russians are harmed, I will move in.
Looking from Russia, one may really think that people in Crimea are in danger. That's if you believe their media. Russia 24 is a good case in point. Running a peace and protests in Simferopol, they used footage of violent clashes on Maidan in Kyiv. While Russia's narrative is nothing surprising, the indifference of Crimeans to the criminal record of their new leaders is bizarre. Since the 1990s, Goblin has been a household nickname in Crimea. Back then, it was an alias of Crimea's incumbent self-proclaimed premier, Sergei Aksyonov. Later, he tried to deny his connections with the underworld in a court of law, but he lost. Another household name is Konsol, a scandalous construction company belonging to the parliamentary speaker Vladimir Konstantinov. There have been several attempts to launch criminal proceedings against him, but each time protectors in high places managed to get him off the hook.
These are old groups that have long been active in Crimea. They date back to the Soviet Union. Practically all of them, Syakov, Konstantinov, they are all in the same boat. The Russians began their plan B to annex Crimea. Konstantinov is always in Moscow. Surkov visits Crimea. They have dug out all the odious figures that used to destabilize Crimea.
Vladislav Surkov is a Putin advisor who deals with South Ossetia and Abkhazia, territories once grabbed by Russia from Georgia with the use of the same methods they applied in Crimea. Russian troops occupied our territory 2 weeks after Surkov visited Simferopol.
Russia planned and prepared a platform, secured key infrastructure. The experts warned us about it many times. This talk started in 2003 after Tuzla, that Russian aggression was quite a threat.
Having made this footage, we could manipulate it the way Russian channels do and say that plenty of people in Crimea support Ukraine's unity. But in fact, this is a Crimean Tatar rally, and they constitute only 10% of all Crimeans. On the peninsula, they are among the few who openly protest against Russia's occupation. Women and children stand along the highways or gather in squares, while men stay in so as not to provoke the pro-Russian population.
We want to remain in Ukraine. We want to live in Ukraine. We are for the territorial integrity of Ukraine. We do not want anyone to destroy our territorial integrity. Half of our relatives are in Ulyanovsk, Nahotka, the Far East. My cousins, how can we talk? How can we be at war? How can such an idea occur to anyone? It never should. It's terrible.
Day and night, the Crimean Tatars stand guard over the entrances to their villages. Crimea had long since forgotten what ethnic strife was all about. But now, the old animosities are resurfacing. This time, not because of religion, though, but because of political divisions. Where does Crimea belong? The Tatars may be able to stand up to the Cossacks, but how can they protect themselves from Russian helicopters? The people who survived deportations know what a totalitarian system is all about.
They are making us do what we don't want to. If there is war, we won't sit quietly. We will go into battle like this. We don't want to be part of Russia.
This is the entrance to one of the Crimean Tatar villages. When it gets dark, men start bonfires. Only those who live here may enter.
Do you believe Aksyonov when he says he'll spend 300 million on Crimean Tatars? Do you think it's true? Who is this Aksyonov? Who elected him? He elected himself and brought Russia in. This party won't last long. He won't keep power forever. He'll get kicked out and will probably flee to Russia like Yanukovych. They're all partners in crime, part of Putin's scenario.
Meanwhile, the Ukrainian Marines in Feodosia are gathered in a briefing room. A Russian general came to negotiate, or rather to demand they lay down arms. While he's talking to the battalion commander in a separate room, the officers get visibly nervous. It's not the first visit of Russia's top brass military to the Ukrainian unit.
The Ukrainian Marine Battalion has sworn an oath to the Ukrainian people, not to some generals from another country. So this was never even an option, and it's still not.
The battalion commander comes out to phone his superiors. Russians threaten to storm the unit in an hour if the Ukrainian servicemen refuse to lay down arms. The Russian general comes to address our officers. He doesn't want to be filmed, but we have an audio recording of what was said by the second commander of Russia's southern military district, Lieutenant General Igor Turchinyuk.
We are here today to persuade you to take your weapons and put them back in the ammunition depot. so we could all guard it together. What is your status exactly? Is it invasion? Vladimir Putin, the president of the Russian Federation, has asked the Russian troops to assist. Assist whom? Assist the Crimean government that legitimately, not the Ukrainian people. Our direct supervisor is the unit commander, Lieutenant Colonel Deletitsky. We report to him. We'll carry out whatever orders he gives us. So you don't think about what's happening up there. The commander has already... What do you mean? I mean, who's in command? Which minister? Where are all these ministers now? Why isn't a single one of them here? A general came from the Russian side, and there's only the unit commander from ours. There you have it.
The negotiations failed. The Ukrainian Marine Battalion refused to surrender.
I have to go now, but I'll call again as soon as I get a chance, okay? All right, honey. I love you. Don't worry. Everything's all right. Say hi to Mom. Bye-bye. Is she worried? Of course she is. Everyone is worried. Everyone is scared. Because television shows one thing and the internet another. But you see what the reality is like. We fortified the unit and that's it. Nothing is really happening. Everyone is in a good mood. And what's important now is to eat and get some rest.
For more than a week, they've been bracing themselves against a possible Russian assault, being outnumbered and outgunned.
They have new pichenyeg machine guns, modernized sniper rifles. We have Dragunov sniper rifles from the Soviet Union, and theirs are new. They have better weapons.
In Simferopol, 120 kilometers from Feodosia, the mood is different. People are welcoming the Russian troops, celebrating either victory or the onset of warm weather. The main square of Crimea's capital is hosting Crimean Spring, a festival of friendship organized by the self-proclaimed government, although it remains unclear what sort of friendship is implied.
Friendship of Nations, Crimean Spring 2014. Let's hear a round of applause.
The Marines are resting. They sleep with their weapons at hand. Sentries and subunit commanders are standing guard. All the conversations are about the situation in the country, the army, and its combat capability. Of course, this unit can repulse the aggressor, but the events of the recent weeks show that the country's defense capability is seriously flawed, or simply non-existent.
How can you prepare for a war reading textbooks? We've accumulated all these papers. In theory, it's possible. We use a few stacks of paper every week. We came back from the firing range on Friday and have to go back there on Monday. When are you supposed to get ready if you have to fill out a stack of papers this big? Operational cards, summaries, diagrams. Why is our army called the UPA? It stands for the Ukrainian Paper Army. Agreed? The most important is to approve the curriculum on Thursday. If military men could own businesses, I would open an office supply store, and I would earn three times more money. Why? Because I need paper. But I don't have any. So what? Go buy some. And I go and buy some paper and blue tape. All that's important in the army is paper and blue tape. When a situation like this arises, we're unprepared. Because no one cares. The army was not a priority of the military and political government of the country. 5 years ago, for the first time, the police budget surpassed the military budget.
Вище за бюджет військовий.
Місцеве населення подогнало.
Це половина. У нас половина вже сьогодні.
Опа. Ну що, значить, давай дивись.
Нас кинули відділ, блін, а ботинки сьогодні протер. Вон, звіж.
Тему ботинок ми вже сьогодні обсудили.
А він протирається ще одно. Нові носки.
Ми сьогодні вже обсуждали і форму, і ботинки.
Да.
Держи. О.
Так ви її так прямо?
They pretend everything's all right. But with armed foreign soldiers standing behind the wall some 30 meters off, dropping one's guard is not an option. The smallest provocation can trigger a war.
Та они туда бежали, с той стороны. Через Байву.
Через мост перебежал.
Три чувака.
Блин, а не видно с левой стороны ничего.
Да, ты видишь, как бы...
Ну да, здесь обзор...
Обзор минимальный. Ну как минимальный? Видно, но не все, да?
Да, вот это вообще, блин, левая часть.
Жестко.
Понимаешь, опять же неправильно. В первую очередь освещение воинской части должно идти...
But only the checkpoint is lit. That's how the nights pass in all the Ukrainian military units blocked by the Russian army. Nobody knows how long it's going to last, except for those who planned Operation Crimea.
In order to hold an assault landing operation in Crimea, it will take a matter of days. It's not that well protected. The question is, what comes next? Next, the war comes. Putin counts on the Ukrainian military and political government to avoid any confrontation. This is his hope.
If Russian troops leave Crimea tomorrow, Aksyonov and Konstantino will face arrest. Criminal cases have already been opened against them. But a retreat is unlikely. In Feodosia, Russian soldiers are not just standing around. They are digging in. An unlawful referendum where Crimeans will decide whether they want separation from Ukraine is to be held on following Sunday. It will be ignored by most of the Crimean Tatars, and not a single civilized country will recognize it. But none of this will prevent Russia from citing its results as legitimate grounds for assuming de jure control over Crimea.
Dear soldiers, we love you all and we wish you victory. This is by first graders of a Kyiv school. These kids are not indifferent to what's happening here now. They sent us their drawings and letters. Good morning, brothers. Today is the first day of Lent. Let's ask God for his help and protection.
Господа Бога, его божественного покрова помощи.
Я не хочу отсюда уезжать никуда. То есть Крым.
I do not want to leave this place. Crimea is a part of Ukraine. It's not up to me to decide. We have a history, we have great intellectuals and politicians. My vote changes nothing, so I'm not even going there. Let those behind the fence think. All power to the people and so on. I can't add anything in this regard. The army is outside of politics. We are not the left, the right, or the radicals. We are the military force that submits to orders. We are the victims of the situation.
Мы силовые структуры, которые вот подчиняемся, и все.
But unlike the government in Kyiv, they at least know what to do. Just build barricades.
Tell my family and parents that I love them. Don't worry, we stand for Ukraine. It's going to be all right.